Yes, sir. Fine, sir.
Greetings from Ramachandra and from Excellent Care Hospital. And I'll be talking about kidney stone disease and overview. To start with, this is what, when I started as a postgraduate, we used to remove the stones. The stones are all removed in toto, and that is how the treatment started. But over a period of last 20 years, the things have moved on, and we have moved from open stone surgeries to many things which I'll be discussing here. Kidney stones is one of the third common disease, and the annual incidence is about 10%. And the most important thing is the chance of stone recurrence in about 10 years is 50%. A patient who is getting treated for stones, the chance of he developing another stone is about 50% in 10 years. Usually the men are more commonly affected than female, and calcium stones are more common. The kidneys are paired organs situated in the retroperitoneum. And from the kidneys, the urine travels through the ureter into the bladder, and then from the bladder it gets emptied. See, the stones can be present at the lower ureter, that is at the vesicoureteric junction. It can be in the lower ureter per se, above the bladder level. It can be the uretic stones which are there, which presents as a common presentation, usually presents with severe loin pain. And this is one of the common conditions which we see regularly in our practice. The stones are usually located in the lower ureter, and patient comes with severe loin pain, nausea, vomiting, and things like that. And here, if you see the patients, the pain radiates from the loin to groin, and sometimes it can be associated with lower urinary tract symptoms when the stones are present in the vesicoureteric junction. And most of the time, when the stones are present in the ureter, the patient asks whether these stones are usually passed spontaneously. And when the stones are small, we allow them to take more fluids and put these patients on conservative line of management. And sometimes these patients pass the stones spontaneously. And there is a subgroup of patients where the stones drop into the bladder and it can become a vesicle calculus. Sometimes it can create more problem by getting stuck in the urethra. So routinely, all patients whom we suspect ureteric calculus or a renal calculus are subjected to a urine routine examination, which may show you numerous RBCs and WBCs. X-ray, which was part of the initial evaluation in the past, has been generally now replaced with the CT-KUB. And ultrasound has become a very important tool in diagnosing stone disease. And the ultrasound-KUB has become a part of a clinical extension. It's no more an investigation where the patient is referred across. Usually, urologists have their own ultrasound, and it has become an extension of a clinical evaluation. And CT is the gold standard for diagnosing kidney stone disease, and that is there to stay. So, in general, we have moved from X-rays to CT scan to have a more accurate diagnosis. This is an X-ray KB which we used to do it in the past, and now also we get the X-ray KBs. What is the problem with the X-ray KB is, if the stone is radiolucent, it can be picked up. If the patient is, if it is radio opaque, it can be picked up. If it is radiolucent, it may not be picked up. That is the reason we have moved from X-ray KUB to CT scan. See, any stones usually gets picked up on a CT. Even like a 4 millimeter stone usually gets picked up. So the specificity and accuracy by doing a CT is much more than doing a KUB. Here you can see a small low uretic stone sitting in the left ureter with the moderate hydroureteronephrosis. So usually in case of stone disease, it's usually a conservative arm which is followed initially. A stone less than about 6 millimeter, 7 millimeter, we usually put the patient on diuretics and alpha blockers to expel the stone out. But if the stone size is more than 8 millimeter, and if it is in the upper ureter, and especially in diabetic patient, then we may have to do an intervention in form of a ureteroscopy, where the scope is passed through the urethra into the bladder and then into the ureter. Where the stones are fragmented, and different energy source can be used. It's a pneumatic which is used routinely, or a laser can also be used to fragment the stone into smaller fragments. So coming to renal calculus, so the treatment for URS, uretic stone, has remained almost same over a period of time. It has been the initial conservative arm of management with the increase of fluids and alpha blockers and pain relief. And ureteroscopy has remained the treatment of choice over a period of time for last 20 years, 30 years. And it is only the thing which has changed is some semi-rigid, we have moved to flexible. But not so in case of kidney stones. In the kidney stones, there are a lot of changes which has happened over a period of last 15-20 years. See here, there is a stone occupying the renal pelvis. and stone can occupy the whole kidney, which is a stag on calculus. So what has been the option in front of us? We had started initially with open surgery. That was a gold standard treatment for any stone disease, and which has been there for last about 80-90 years. And then came the ESWL, where it's an extracorporeal shortwave lithotripsy, where the stones were fragmented from outside and patients were made to pass as fragmented particles through urine. Then came the PCNL, which is a percutaneous nephrolithotomy. And then came the mini PERC and RARS, which I'll be dealing in detail. So ESWL, where do we do ESWL? What is the current position of ESWL? ESWL had its peak in 1980s and early 1990s. See, this was the standard care which was given for a patient with a small stone. But the problem is when the stone is very dense, the stones are not getting fragmented easily, or the stones which are situated in the lower calyx, the fragmentation was not very great. So the complete clearance were not achieved by doing a ESWL. So the ESWL currently, what we do is for small stones less than 1 centimeter, and stones occupying the middle and upper calyx are subjected to ESWL. Stones in general of the lower calyx, we don't do a ESWL because the stone clearance rate is not that great. So in general, the smaller stones situated in the renal pelvis, middle and upper calyx can be subjected to ESWL, but stones in the lower calyx less than 1 centimeter also, we don't prefer to do a ESWL because of the poor stone clearance. So this is the machine which usually an ultrasound or a fluoroscopy is used to target the stones, and the stones are fragmented into pieces. You may require 1 or 2 sittings to fragment the stone, and the stones are usually expelled. In general, you don't usually put in a stent, but if the stone volume is big and we expect the stones can get blocked in the ureter, then stenting is essential. But then in general, in case of ESWL, we tend to avoid putting in a stent preoperatively. Then came the open surgery. This was a gold standard, and which is used to be done for all complex stones where the stone volume was great. The surgeries were pyelolithotomy, extended pyelolithotomy, and anatropic pyelolithotomy. These are all open surgeries which are done for removal of the stones. This has become a history now. We generally don't do any open surgeries for stones at present. See, here you can see anatropic pyelolithotomy. The stone was a large volume stone. So we open into the kidney and inspect the individual calyces and remove the stones. So this was one of the methods which was done in the past, but no more anatropic pyelolithotomy or pyelolithotomy is being practiced these days, except in patients with renal failure. So what has become the mainstay in treatment of kidney stone is a PCNL. So PCNL is nothing but a percutaneous nephrolithotomy. So what we used to see the world like stones by opening the door. That is an open surgery. From there, we have moved to keyhole surgeries, and the keys over a period of time have become smaller. So PCNL is in general a monotherapy in case of small volume stones. Stones less than 4 centimeters, we should have an excellent clearance, almost about 95 to 100% stone clearance. And this has become a monotherapy. And next is when the stone volume is large. That means to say that it's about complete occupying the kidney. Then sometimes we may not be able to clear a good clearance. So we may be able to clear the stone in a couple of sittings. Then also it becomes a monotherapy. Or sometimes a small residual calculus may require a ESWL at a later date for a complete clearance. And PCNL is done from 6 months of life to any age group. The age group is not an issue as long as they are anesthetically fit to be lying down prone. So PCNL is carried out. So what is this PCNL and how is it done, and what are the gadgets which are used, and what has been the recent update in gadgets, and what are the issues and concern, and what are the long-term results? That's what I'm going to have a look at. And PCNL, the Ramchandra Medical College is one of the centers which does about 600 PCNLs, one of the largest in the country. And we do about 600 PCNLs in a year. And this is a minimally invasive endoscopic treatment. Usually patients are made to lie down in the prone position, and a small incision about 1 centimeter is given in the back, and an axis is developed between the pellicalcial system to the exterior. So patient is in the prone position, and using a CM, the stone is targeted, and incision is made. First is the targeting of the stone using a CM in 0 and 30 degree. Then we make a small incision, which is about 1 centimeter incision. and then we try and establish a communication between the pelvic calcium system to the exterior. And once we develop a pelvic communication between the pelvic calcium system to the exterior, we dilate and make a tract. So this is a tract, PCNL tract. And then once we make a tract, that is, it goes straight into the pelvic calcium system. Then we visualize the stone and break the stone into pieces. And then we remove the stone and then make sure the stone is getting clear, complete clearance. So what used to start as a keyhole surgery, then the key became smaller. So what we started as a 1.5, 2 centimeter incision, the keys have become smaller. And from PCNL, we have moved on to mini perk and ultra mini perk and the micro perk. What are all these things? The PCNL, we make about an incision about 1 to 1.5 centimeter. And in mini perk about a centimeter, and ultra mini perk about 5 millimeter, and micro perk about 2 millimeter. The size of the incision have come down drastically over a period of time. So that is what is happening. And because of this, is this was all possible only because of the gadgets which are available. This is because the gadgets became smaller, and so that even a small stone about 1.5 centimeter, 2 centimeter stones are usually dealt with a small incision and with about 20 size, that is about 1 centimeter incision. Yes, especially in pilots and sailors whom we are expected to have a complete stone clearance, all these modalities came into play. Especially when you have a small stone which requires a complete clearance, we make a small incision about 5 millimeter and do ultra mini perk or a micro perk where the stones are all powdered and dusted, and so that the patient passes off all the stone. So what started as a PCNL has moved on to ultra mini perk and a micro perk. So this is what, this is a laser fiber through which the stones are all powdered and dusted. We make about a 2 millimeter incision in doing a micro perk.
Sir, what did you say? That's what I'm talking about.
And other thing is RIRS. So why to see, we start with open and then we made an incision smaller. Then there was a thought, why to make an incision at all? Can we do it through the normal urinary passage without making any opening? That is where the retrograde intrarenal surgery came into picture. And here, from the open to a keyhole to a lock, which is without any holes. So what we did was, we used to pass a scope from below, through the urethra into the ureter and reach the kidney. And using a laser fiber, the stones are all powdered and dusted. And the patient was able to pass it, pass all the stone fragments through the urine. Here, only criteria was the stone load should be about 2 to 2.5 centimeter. Maximum, we can go up to 3 centimeters, which can we can do a retrograde intrarenal surgery where the stones are all powdered and dusted under vision. ESWL, the stones are all powdered and dusted without, it is only from the external. We don't know how much fragmentation was happening. But here, under vision, all procedure is done so that the stone clearance rates are much better, especially with the advancement of gadgets and advancement in the laser fibers, the probes. This is all is possible now. So here, the scope is passed into the kidney. Each calyx can be visualized, the lower, the middle, the upper can be visualized. And then the stones can be basketed from the upper and the lower calyces and put into the pelvis, and the stone can be fragmented completely with a good, excellent clearance rate with the less morbidity and mortality. This is all because of the advancement in the gadgets. So what is the role of diet in any kidney stones? The common question is there any diet restriction? Usually in first-time stone formers and stones of on one's kidney, we usually don't restrict the patient on any diet. We generally ask them to have plenty of fluids. So that is the mainstay of treatment. That is what which can be followed. But in children and adults who have got a bilateral large volume stones, a metabolic workup is done. And based on that, the dietary modifications are advised. In general, we don't restrict any patients on diet too much in these days. Encourage them to take about 2 to 2.5 liters of water per day. And most important thing, we make sure that the pass about at least 4 to 5 times in a day urine, and each time should be about 300 to 400 ml, and the urine color has to be clear. If the urine color is not clear, we tell them it is concentrated, make sure. That is a simple advice which can be given to the patient, that you pass urine 4 to 5 times and the urine color has to be clear. So yeah, urology is one specialty where we have embraced the change of all these technologies which is happening around us. So from this type of stone which we used to pass in remove we had moved on. We had started breaking the stone to about 1 centimeter, 1.5 centimeter and removing. Now it's all getting dusted into powder. So that is the technology what is happening around us. And there has been a shift in management from open to endoscopic procedures. It's something like that. When we started, we all had an Ambassador and Maruti, and from that we moved to Audi, and now we are into electrical car. Something like that. That's what is happening in the field of urology also, in the management of stone disease. We are moving from open to endoscopic to laser, and that is where it is likely to stay. And then there can be refinement of instruments which can make all these procedures as a daycare procedure. Patients nowadays usually don't stay in the hospital for more than 24 to 48 hours in any of the stone management. Usually in past, we make the patient stay for about a week to 10 days whenever you do open surgeries. The PCNL, the stay is usually about 48 hours. And in case of RIRS, it's usually less than 24 hours. So that is what is happening in management of stone disease. At the end of the day, whatever the technology, whatever the technique, or whatever it is, the most important thing, you should have an excellent stone clearance. That is what the essence of the treatment is. If you don't have a good stone clearance, the chance of recurrence is high and chance of having a residual stone is high. So whatever modality, see, for any given patient, that modality has to be talked and discussed with the patient, and then appropriately it should be handled so that we give an excellent stone rate. So the chance of having a recurrence comes down drastically when you don't have a residual stone. And the acceptable morbidity. So all these stones, whenever there's a stone, the chance of having a urosepsis is high. The chance of having an associated UTA and some sort of a hematuria can be there in some of the given patients. But off late, I don't think any of the stone patients whom we have managed, we have lost. So that is very, very important in the essential of treatment of stone disease. We don't want any mortality. Some morbidity here and there is okay, but then no mortality should be the aim of any management of stone disease. It should be planned, it should be optimized, the condition has to be optimized, and it should be planned for a given patient. The patient can be morbid, the patient can have comorbid disease, the patient may present with the renal failure. So all these things should be optimized and then taken up. So what is the most important thing which has happened around us is the miniaturization of the instruments, which has made us move from open to endoscopic, and from making a big incision to small incision and without incision. That is what where we stand right now. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Dr. K. Natarajan, KN. We used to call Dr. KN for exhaustive lecture. And any members, if you have any doubt, you can raise your hand so that you can type your question in a chat box, so we can ask to the speaker.
President? No. Dr. Shanmugasundaram here.
Good evening, sir.
Good evening. You know, the one common question which my patients used to ask is like, you know, in a person with proven calcium stones, you know, can we take, you know, calcium supplements as recommended by you? This is a common question which is asked by them.
No issues in having a calcium supplement, sir. We don't restrict them on any calcium supplement, sir.
Okay. Thank you.
Hello.
Thank you, sir.
Hello.
Yes, sir. Go ahead, sir.
Yes, sir. Go ahead.
Am I audible?
Yes, sir. You're audible, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. I just want to know what is the role of any medical treatment and some of the native treatment giving the juice of plant entry and all is very effective. What is your opinion? Is it whenever is the stone is there, is it always surgical or medical treatment also can be given?
So at the end of the day, what is required is the stone has to be expelled out or it should be removed. So if the stones are small, any of these native treatments can work. So there's no all these things becomes like a diuretic and it can expel the stone out. So there are roles in native treatment. We don't discourage the patients not to go and not to do this. But then at the end of the day, a 3 centimeter stone doesn't break and fragment easily and pass on into the urine, sir. So it depends on the small stone, that is fine, but not for a large volume stone.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. Members, thank you. Any members have a questions you can ask? Okay, sir. So the problem is,
sir,
because
can we give alpha blocker, sir? alpha blocker.
Alpha blockers, we usually wait for about 2 weeks, sir.
2 weeks. Once along with the steroid?
If by 2 weeks they don't pass it off, then I think we should go for an intervention, sir.
Okay, sir. The steroid also, sir.
Steroid in general, we don't recommend, sir, because some of the patients can be diabetic. So, as a general protocol, we don't give steroids, sir.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Generally, teaching will be the one stone comes, it's a lifelong stone. Am I right, sir? KN, sir?
Yeah. Most of the time it happens, but a small stone doesn't tend to recover, but large stones, yes.
Yes, sir. One stone in our body, your life. That is what the carry home message. Yeah. Can you take it? This is a carry home message for this?
100%, sir. Plenty of water, especially 2.5 to 3 liters of per day. That will make you.